And this is the title of a paper that came out of a PhD thesis I supervised 10 years ago by Ruchira Datta, and this was published in Mathematics of Operations Research. So this is a very special example of what will be covered in more depth and generality in the next two lectures on geometric universality. So it's a very special example of geometric universality. So Nash studied game theory in the 50s. So let's recall the notion of a game in normal form. So a normal form game, I think this was first introduced on von Neumann, then picked up by Nash. And in my lecture, I will focus on the situation with three players, although everything I say works for n players. So we have three players, and each player has a finite list of choices. So let's say the first player, I'm going to index these choices by positive integers. The first player, 1 up to alpha. The second player, 1 up to beta. And finally, the third player has gamma choices. So imagine the first player has 10,000 euros to invest, and he wants to decide whether it should be Google or Facebook or Microsoft stock he wants to buy. The second player has two job offers, one from Bonn and one from Berlin, and he or she can't make up their mind which is better. And finally, the third one wants to buy dinner tonight, and he can go to Netto or Aldi or Rewe, and again, can't quite make up his mind. So those are the kind of choices. To specify the game, there are payoff tables. And these tables are really tensors. So the first player has a three-dimensional tensor with entries ai, jk, where I is from 1 up to alpha, j is from 1 up to beta, k is from 1 up to gamma. The second player has his payoff table, again, bi, jk. And the third player has a payoff table, c. So you can see how this goes. In general, if we have n players, then we have n-dimensional tensors. And the interpretation is that, let's say these are positive real entries. And the interpretation is that if the player, the first player, chooses I, their choice I, these are sometimes called pure strategy. The second player chooses the pure strategy J, and the third player chooses the pure strategy K, then the first player will receive A, I, J, K euros. Okay? Likewise, the second player and the third player. So this is, if everybody chooses one of these pure strategies, Rewe, Berlin, Microsoft, then this is the amount in euros that the player will receive. It doesn't matter. It could actually be any real number. But that's just to think about it, you know, to sort of visualize it. Let's think about positive numbers. But it could be negative, right? You could imagine that going to Netto is a punishment or something like that, that there's a negative reward, okay? So let's play. So in the actual game, the way this is set up in game theory, actually each player selects a mixed strategy, not a pure strategy, but a mixed strategy. And a mixed strategy is a probability distribution on the pure strategies. So the first player has a discrete probability distribution, A1 up to A alpha in my notation. So this is in the alpha minus one-dimensional probability simplex. So he picks a list of non-negative real numbers that sum to one. So think about, he has $10,000 to euros to invest, and he simply splits them among the three spots according to proportions, alpha 1, alpha 2, and so on. Likewise, the second player picks a distribution in his simplex. So if it's between Berlin and Bonn, this would be a line segment, right? So it has a distribution. And finally, the third guy can't make up his mind among the three supermarkets, and he picks something in his triangle. Sort of, maybe he spends 10 euro on this supermarket, 25 euro on another one, and so on. Okay? Now, after everybody makes their choices, there is a payoff. And the payoff is allocated according to the payoff tables but with the probabilities, you know, multiplied by the probabilities. So it's exactly what you think it is, but let me write it out. So the first player receives a certain number of euros, so that's a sum, A, I, J, K, alpha I, beta J, gamma K, euros, right? So if there were a pure strategy, if alpha, beta, and gamma were 0, 1, were unit vectors, then we would just get the corresponding entry in this table, but now we're mixing the strategies, so this is the quantity you get. So we think about these tensors, these three-dimensional tensors, as trilinear forms. We're simply evaluating this trilinear form at this triple of probability distributions, and so on, right? So second player receives his share. He has his own trilinear form. And finally, the third player receives a payoff. That's the value of the trilinear form C.
But the notation is A, B, C.
So.
No, I mean, A, B, C.
Did I write something?
Is it true that it became alpha beta gamma somehow?
Let's see. So the. No, 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 it's okay. So the vector, the distribution, maybe my notation isn't perfect. Oh, I see. Yes, 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 yes. Absolutely. Yes, you're absolutely right. Hoppala, let's fix it. It's early on Monday morning, so AI, BJ, CK, AI, BJ, CK. See, that's another advantage of a blackboard talk. It's easy to fix, right? Not so easy with the slide. Okay, so now everybody has picked their choices. Now let's look at the outcome, right? So are we in a stable situation? So we're going to say that the point ABC, so we're inside this product of three simplices, a polytope, as the Bolino sure will recognize and think about the effect already. So the point in this polytope is a Nash equilibrium if everybody is happy. Define this. So it's a Nash equilibrium. I'm going to say this in words. So if no player can by themselves unilaterally increase their payoff, by changing their mixed strategy. Okay? So by changing his mixed strategy. Okay? So you can imagine these players, they make their choices. Afterwards, we look at these choices. You say, whoops, you know, maybe I didn't make such a good choice at all, right? You cannot, of course, control what the other people choose, but maybe you could say, well, I could have chosen a different A, right? The first player could have chosen a different A and get a higher payoff without changing B or C. So if neither of these three players can do that, improving their payoff just by changing their own mixed strategy, then we're in the situation of a Nash equilibrium. Okay, so this is the setup. So let me write N for the set of Nash equilibria. Of the game specified by my three tensors. So I have the tensors A, B, C, and there we go. So if you give me A, B, C, then N is a set of Nash equilibria, and this N is a subset of my polytope delta, which is the direct product of these three simplices. Okay? So that's the set of all Nash equilibria. Now, maybe a word. So if you study this, so if you ever take a course in game theory, and there's textbooks and there are courses often taught in economics, 99% of all examples that you'll see in the textbooks are for two-player games. Okay, and there are big, big differences between two-player games and games with three or more players. And we'll see that the complexity that we're discussing today comes entirely because we have more than two players. So we'll see that. Another thing, you know, of course, this is a very popular day, a very, very popular topic. So in the last 10 years, I would say at the interface of computer science and economics with e-commerce, there has been a huge interest. And lots of results have been proven. And this was sort of an early math contribution by Ruchira that I think received quite a bit of attention. So that's what I'm talking about here. Okay. So Nash proved that these things exist. So theorem of Nash. (clears throat) 1950 says the set of Nash equilibria is always non-empty. Right? So for any choice, for any real tables, A, B, C, there will always... It could be negative, exactly. A, B, C is any real table. I just sort of wanted to tell the story as positive rewards. A, B, C are real tables with real entries, and there's always at least one Nash equilibrium. So N is a non-empty subset of this closed, compact, convex polytope. Okay? So how is this proven? Well, Nash proves this by using topological argument. So there are fixed points, topological fixed points theorems that imply this. So there's a topological argument that says regardless what A, B, and C is, N will always be a non-empty set. Okay. Yes, sure. We have lots of time, actually. Yes, sorry. Mm-hmm. Only for yourself. Only for yourself. So your own trilinear form is a linear function in your choice. So all you can do, if I'm player, the first player, I can wiggle my vector A, and everything is linear in my A. So if I can improve my payoff by changing my A only, I have no control over B and C, and I can increase the value of my trilinear form, then we were not in Nash equilibrium. Is that clear? So that's the situation. I've given you sort of a wordy definition, but I'm going to translate this into polynomial algebra in a minute. Okay. So let me write N0, this is important, for those, the subset of those Nash equilibria that are in the interior of my polytope. So this, such a Nash equilibrium exists, and it may be on the boundary, it may be on the interior. So this is the set of Nash equilibria technical term is, people, economists call this the set of fully mixed Nash equilibria. A, B, C. Okay, so the vector A, B, C is in the interior of the simplex. Every coordinate is strictly positive between 0 and 1. Every coordinate is strictly positive. So that's a Nash equilibrium where every choice appears with the positive probability. Okay? So you could imagine, right, so if this were not fully mixed, maybe we're ruling out Microsoft because we don't like Microsoft, then we would be located on some face of this polytope. So these are those Nash equilibria that are in the interior that actually use all the choices. Okay? These are the fully mixed ones. Now, this may be empty. Okay? So this set of fully mixed Nash equilibria will be empty. And the point of this talk is that these are semi-algebraic sets. So of course, N, the set of all Nash equilibria, is a finite union of various N zeros over the various faces. Right? So This polytope has a certain number of faces, and these guys already know how many. And then as we take a union over the finite list of all these faces, then everything's a semi-algebraic set, but we're going to concentrate our attention on n0. Okay? So we're going to be, because this is sort of a case distinction. Now, in the case of two-player games, the games that sort of cover 99% of what's taught in courses, all the complexity comes by sorting out the faces. As we'll see, this semi-algebraic set is a linear space. It will be described by linear equations if we were in the situation of a two-person game. So just like linear programming, two-player games are linear problems. So there's no algebraic complexity in the problem. There's only combinatorial complexity. The difficulty comes from the fact that there are many faces on which there could be Nash equilibria, but typically, on each face, you sort of have at most one. There will be a linear system of equations, but we're going to be interested in players with games with three players, where we have algebraic complexity. And that is Ruggiero's result, so theorem. Questions, comments? Everything clear? So this is Dada, 2003. Says the following, every semi-algebraic set can be realized as the set N0 of Nash equilibria of an n-person game, of a three-person game. Wait a second, let me finish the sentence. Of a three-player game. Okay, there's a little bit of fine print, right? So the interior of my polytope is a homeomorphic to R to the n for an appropriate n. So if you have a semi-algebraic set, could be open, could be closed, given Boolean combination of polynomial inequalities with real coefficients, then you know there's an isomorphism in the category of real algebraic varieties that takes you into the simplex and realizes this. So in English, you know, if Ileana gives me her favorite system of polynomial equations and inequalities with real coefficients, I can find matrices, tables A, B, C, such that my N0 is essentially the same as your set. Okay, so this is the universality.
Theorem about universality.
It is a universality. It's a universe. So as I said, it's a very special case of the kind of geometric universality theorems we're going to hear about in the next two talks. Okay, now the same is also true for n-player games. Of 2x2x2 format. So, somehow, you know, of course, as our semi-algebraic sets become more complicated, well, here, sort of the complexity that I have, I can choose alpha, beta, gamma. So, if you give me a complicated semi-algebraic set, I'm going to make my alpha, beta, gamma fairly large to realize your semi-algebraic set. And if I were a computer scientist, I would say this could be done in polynomial time. So I can encode your thing in polynomial time. If I have binary choices, so often you have situations with binary choices, we can also do that, but then the number of players will be large. The complexity is in the number of players. Okay, so let me talk a little bit in general. So I'm not going to give you the full proof, but let me tell you a little bit how to derive the equations, how to write down what's the nature of the equations of N0 from A, B, C. Okay, so if you give me tables, how do I derive the equations? So I'm going to tell you yes. Uh, Yeah, it's exactly. It's over the ground field. So the construction is over the ground field. So if your variety is defined over Q, my game is defined over Q. Now, I like tropical geometries, so if you give me, you know, entries in an ordered, real closed field with evaluation, voila, my entries will be there. So we can certainly tropicalize. And so it's over the ground field. Okay. So how do you actually, let me sort of give the forward question. I mean, universality is nice, but in some sense, often universality thought of as a negative thing. Right? It's a little bit like when you take your first course in Galois theory. Right? You take a course in Galois theory, and then the professor lectures for a long time, you know, and then comes the end of 4 weeks, comes this crowning accomplishment that says, well, now you can't do this. Right? You can't trisect the angle. You can't do that. You can't do that. It's a little, for me, a little unsatisfying. Okay, so I think I like to sort of see this as a positive thing. So it sort of delineates, you know, that we can talk about arbitrary real polynomial problems. But let's sort of think about the forward direction for a moment. So starting from the payoff table, how do we actually solve the game? Okay. So, what does our set and not typically look like? Before we get to back to universality, let's say you give me sort of random matrices A, B, C. What do we expect this set to look like? So here's a proposition that describes this. So N0 is defined in the interior. So I have unknowns a1, a2, and so on that are positive real numbers. And in this interior, it's defined by a system of alpha plus beta plus gamma minus 3 bilinear equations. In the same number of unknowns. So first of all, the number of unknowns is the right one, right? Because the first person has alpha choices, but he picks a probability distribution, so he has alpha minus 1 degrees of freedom in picking his distribution. Likewise, the second person has beta minus 2, and so on. So the number of free parameters is exactly this number, alpha plus beta plus gamma minus 3. And we're going to set up a system of polynomials of exactly the same number of polynomials. So we have a square system of polynomial equations whose solutions is our N naught.
Plus gamma.
Absolutely, plus gamma. Okay, so there's a delicate case distinction. So I could also, you know, set up a system of equations that covers the boundary, but then there's sort of a combinatorial complexity of case distinction that's sort of complicated in some sense. So yes, but I'm not saying that every semi-algebraic subset, you know, as it stands, of the simplex is realizable.
Yeah,
that's I think that's wrong. I think that's wrong. Yeah, by discrete. Yeah, I think. You mean like? Yeah. I think it's wrong. I believe that it's wrong. So again, let me say this again. There's sort of an issue, there are two issues. There's combinatorial complexity and there's algebraic complexity. And they're both serious, and we're separating them out. We're saying, let's separate the combinatorial complexity, namely which phase to choose and where to look from the algebraic complexity that's involved in solving this harmless looking system of bilinear equations. That's where the algebraic complexities.
This proposition is true for any number of players.
This is true for any number of players. So in general, I'm going to write down the equations. So in general, if we have n players, we get a multilinear system of equation that's n minus 1 linear. So for two players, it's linear. For three players, it's bilinear. For four players, it's trilinear, and so on. So one less than the number of players. So that's why two players is special. It would be a linear system. But for three players, we're a bilinear system. And I'm going to write it down for you. So here it is. So J is sum over all J and K. So these are the choices of players 2 and 3. And you go A, I, J, K. Hopefully I get it right now. B, J, C, K. So this is now a bilinear expression. And this has to be equal to the sum also over all J and K of A, I plus 1, J, K. And here I goes from 1 to alpha minus 1. Okay, so there's a system of alpha minus 1 bilinear equations, and it's bilinear B, J, C, K. Okay, it's bilinear just in the B's and the C's. Okay, so I get alpha minus 1 equations that are bilinear in B and C. And you can see how this, how the other ones go. So we sum over I and K. We go B, I, J, K, A, I, C, K. So these are the equations coming from the second player. So I, K, we go B, I, J plus 1, K, A, I, C, K. And now we go J from 1 up to beta 1. And then finally the same thing for the last player. We're summing over J and K. So we're summing over cities and supermarkets, CIJK, AIBJ, it's the sum, JK, C, whoops, I think I should sum over I and J, huh? Sum over I and J, and now we're going to go CIJK plus 1, AIBJ. So K goes from 1 up to gamma 1, and we're summing over stocks and cities. So this one.
No, I mean the first one.
So the first one, all I'm saying is you look at these equations. You're summing out J and K, and then they're all equal.
Yeah.
That's right. It's independent of I. That is correct. So this expression is independent of I. So we're summing out J and K, and the bilinear form sort of is independent of I. This one is independent of J. This one is independent of K. So how is the derivation? Well, the derivation is, it's not complicated, but if I try to give... the number of unknowns, well, so here, yes, so these things sum to 1. So the A's, A1 up to A alpha sums to 1. So I can write this as a homogeneous system, or I can write this as an inhomogeneous system. So the last A is 1 minus the sum of the other A's, the last B is 1 minus the sum of the other B's, and so on. So you can either think about this, if you wish, as a product of projective spaces or in the simplex, and then it's really alpha plus beta plus gamma minus 3 unknowns. Okay, so the derivation, and I'm just going to give you the reference, so page 72, and there's a little booklet I wrote around the same time called Solving Systems of Polynomial Equations. And it's worked out on page 72. It's one of those things we have to sort of unravel the sentence. So there's the sentence, what it means to be a Nash equilibrium. You bear in mind that it depends linearly in each individual person. And then you sort of take the derivative. You know, if you take the derivative of a trilinear form, you get a bilinear form. And a tiny bit of massaging gets you there. So it's fairly elementary. Now, what is sort of the typical behavior? Well, Let's record the Newton polytopes. So if you see such a system, let's say a word about the Newton polytopes. Well, they are as follows. So the first Newton polytope is a point times the second person's simplex times the last person's simplex. Okay? And we have alpha 1 of those. So after I dehomogenize, let's say I dehomogenize, right? So these equations all have the same Newton polytope, you know, which is the support of these equations. So A doesn't occur, so we have a point, and now we have this Toblerone, right? This product of two simplices. And then, so these, we have alpha 1 times, and then the second one, delta alpha 1 times a point times the last one, beta minus 1 times, and finally, delta alpha 1 times delta beta 1 times a point, gamma minus 1 times. Okay, so this is the situation. You have a bilinear system of bilinear equations with these supports, with the support structure, and you can imagine it's the same thing, you know, for n players, the corresponding story. Now, and of course, if you think about this for a moment, we get any square system with these Newton polytopes. So you can work backwards. So if you're given AB, the tables ABC, you get the system of equations. But if Kea now gives me a system of bilinear equations with this structure, I can read off the tables. I can come up with tables that, you know, match the system. So Dada's universality statement says that this very special looking system of bilinear equations is universal. So I can take any, of course we know and we hear more this week about quadratic equations and so on being universal. So what we're saying is that this very special system, bilinear system, is universal. Let's put it up. Okay, maybe a word about Bernstein's theorem concerning the expected number of solutions. So we mentioned Bernstein's theorem. On the expected number of solutions, well, in this situation, so for general payoff tables A, B, C, the number of complex solutions and by complex, I mean the number of solutions in the algebraic closure of the ordered field I started with. So the number of complex solutions that have non-zero entries, fully mixed complex solutions, is the mixed volume. Is the mixed volume of these Newton polytopes. And moreover, all solutions can be real, and lie in the interior of our polytopes when we take products of linear forms. The nice thing about the multilinear equations is that you can sort of model them as products of linear forms. You can degenerate them or to products of linear forms, make statements about products of linear forms, and things will be okay. So let's look at this situation. So for example, let's look at the situation where alpha, beta, gamma is 3. So we have 3 players. Each player has 3 choices. So then our system is 6 equations. We need to solve in 6 unknowns. And let's see, the number of solutions will be 10. And I'm going to convince you of that by simply writing down the corresponding products of linear forms. So by a dot, I simply mean a real number that we get. So the first one is a real number times b1, something times b2, plus something. So now I dehomogenize. So I take b3, I replace b3 by 1 minus b1 minus b2. So there we go. And then times something c1, something c2, times something is 0. Right? So that's a perfectly good bilinear equation. And then the first player has a second equation like this, something b1 plus something b2. And so on, some other constants. I'm going to write this out in gory detail. So then the second player, something a1 plus something a2 plus some other number. And then the same with the c's. It's equal to 0. Oh. No, the first two are the same. Yeah? No. So these dots are random real numbers. Okay, so these are a bunch of real numbers. Right? So this is, pick a real number, pick a different real number, pick a different real number. So every dot represents a different real number. Pick a... Okay, so I look at the first equation. What am I doing? Did I do something wrong? I'm not done yet. Yeah, they look equal, but they have different coefficients, right? This, because there are two. So I look, let me write them all down and then we can discuss, okay? I have 3 more lines to go, okay? So, okay, let me write it down. Yeah, I should have written numbers, right? This is 13. 17, 5, 9, 81, 28, and so on. They look alike, but they're different real numbers, okay? Okay, so just to kind of get a... Okay, and I'm going to write this out. The last one, okay, we have 6 bilinear equations. Okay, now becomes B. Sorry about that. No. I counted wrong, huh? C, now we're B, poo. B2, we have 5 and 1 more to go. Okay. B1. Okay, so now I have 6 equations in 6 equations and 6 unknowns, and it's early on the Monday morning. So how many solutions are there? Okay, well, you think about this. Well, of course, they're at most 64, right? Because you pick one from each, right? So you can pick one from each, but some of these choices, 54. Out of these choices don't have a solution, but 10 of them you have a solution. So there are 10 solutions. Well, so for example, okay. So for example, this A equation and this A equation and this A equation are inconsistent. because I have three random linear equations and two inhomogeneous unknowns, and they don't have a solution, right? But if I pick, for example, two B's here, two A's there, no, that doesn't work. Let's say two C's here, two A's there, and two B's there, that will have a unique solution. That's one out of the 10. Is this clear? So I go through all 2 to the 6 equals 64 possibilities, and 10 of them I will have a solution. And furthermore, you know, I can arrange these coefficients in such a way that I have 10 fully mixed Nash equilibria, right, out of this. So I can turn this, choose these coefficients so that my 10 solutions are all strictly positive between 0 and 1, right? In fact, so the A1 plus A2 better be less than 1 in their sum, so I can fix it in such a way that everything lies in the interior of my polytope.
This is true for open set in
the space of A2. So general means generic in the sense of algebraic geometry. So for a Zariski dense subset in the space of coefficients, and here by can be, I mean there is a classically open Zariski dense set of coefficients that makes this true. Okay? So for random Zariski dense behavior, the number of fully mixed Nash equilibria will be 0, 1, 2, 3, well, maybe not 1, maybe 0, 2, 4, 6, 8, or 10. Okay, that's a positive result, but then we're sort of saying you can also encode other stuff. So let me write this number 10, so in the meantime, the Berliners might have the general formula. So this is the mixed volume of my 6 four-dimensional Toblerones. So, yes? Well, I can put a little epsilon, right? So I can choose. What I'm saying is there exists a choice, an open Zariski dense choice that makes them all. But I might also have zero solutions, right? I can sort of, if I put, you know, make the wrong choice and add constants, I might also have zero real solutions. But I sort of put this up because this is the paradigm. Maybe I should mention this because we have lots of time. So how do people solve these things nowadays? So of course, some people use Gruppner bases. Other people use numerical methods. And the numerical algebraic geometry, we're deforming our system to this structure. So this is a system that's easy to solve. We can write down the 10 solutions. But then we make a homotopy. We perturb in the space of coefficients to our given equations. And we pull back the 10 solutions. So this is sort of the generic behavior. But you know, you could imagine for special choices, special things happen, and it's exactly Dutta's result. So let me write the number 10 as a permanent, just for the fun of it. And then we're almost done. So for multilinear systems, you can always write the number of solutions, the expected number of solutions, as permanent. So we simply take our structure and encode it as 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, right? For the first row, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0. 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, and the permanent of this matrix is 10. Okay, so the permanent is the same as the determinant, except every minus is a plus. Right, so we can code the number 10, and that works in general. So that's another way of phrasing the mixed volume of the Newton polytopes. Okay, so Ruchira showed that you can encode everything in these bilinear systems. She makes a nice remark in the paper. Nash did a lot of things, actually. Here's another theorem of Nash. So This was stated and partially proved by Nash, and then completed by Tonoli. Tonoli without the second G. So Nash wrote about this in 1952. And Tonoli, Italian geometer, completed it in the 70s. And it says the following. It's another universality theorem. Every compact differentiable manifold over the reals, yeah. So every compact real differentiable manifold is diffeomorphic to a real algebraic variety. It's just a side remark to some real algebraic variety. And well, you know, if you combine, it's sort of a fun remark, if you combine sort of these two strands in Nash's work, right, the Nash-Tonoli theorem with the study of Nash equilibria, you could maybe conclude corollary that sets of Nash equilibria are universal among differentiable manifolds. Right, so if you had a way of encoding this, you sort of start with some other description of a differentiable manifold, and then we can run Ruchira's polynomial time encoding, we get a game that realizes a differential manifold. So I'm going to be done way, way early. So there'll be lots of time for discussions and lunch. Maybe I'll sort of end with two stories on the subject. Well, maybe one story. I really got into this through the movie A Beautiful Mind. And that's a separate story, you know. It was this memorable day when I called my wife. Who exactly is this guy, Russell Crowe, that I'm supposed to have dinner with? So that's not the story. So the story is, so when we worked on this, I thought, well, now we have these very nice ways of solving these equations. It would be nice to get some examples, right? So I looked in the book, in the books, sort of almost every example you see in the book is a two-player game. So there are almost no good examples with three or four-player games. And that was sort of before my colleagues in computer science, like Christos Papadimitriou and others, sort of really got into this. So I went to the economics department, which is in the same building, and I asked, you know, our mathematical economist. I said, you know, I have a student, we're working on these Nash equilibria, we, you know, interested in three or four-person games, don't you guys have some data? And he looked at me as if I were from outer space. What do you mean data? You know, this is the economics department in Berkeley, you know, what do you mean data? I mean, they were doing theories in infinite dimensional Hilbert spaces. I mean, they had no data, I mean, period. So there's certainly no data to be had from our economics department. But what I realized also in the study of doing this, that across campus, there were an enormous number of people who knew the definition and the concept of a Nash equilibrium. I think there were more people on our campus who knew what a Nash equilibrium is than people who knew what a polynomial is. I ran into a delightful young man who got a PhD in political science. He was from maybe Argentina, and he sort of know very little math, but he was doing a comparative study about when the sort of countries formed in South America, how they were competing, you know, economically and in the early 1800s, and he sort of used Nash equilibria, and I think he was the one who was sort of most interested in what we did. He did not know what a polynomial was, but he was the most interested in talking to us. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you for a remarkable talk, especially on the first topic of our meeting. Please, questions? Please.
Olivia.
One question. What kind of equivalence between your given algebraic set and the set you define by this?
Okay, so I guess you have a notion of, it's an actual isomorphism of semi-algebraic sets. So maybe one way to do this is to take every inequality and turn it into an equation, right? Because whenever you have an inequality, you can make an extra variable and turn it into equations. And then maybe it's isomorphism of schemes over R. But non-reduced. Yes. Non-reduced. You give me a scheme over R, okay, and we're going to make that scheme as the set of Nash equilibria. Yeah, it's strong. It's. I mean, the structure. Yeah, it's a relatively. I mean, it's not very complicated. It's easier than the matroid universality.
So the all this universality sits on the complement of the risk-dense set.
That's correct. It's all the complexities in a low-dimensional space of payoff tables. So the ABC space is stratified, and these are very, very, very special strata.
It's opposite to very often universality.
Well, that's interesting. Well, maybe we'll hear a little talk about this more in the next couple lectures. So I think also in the context of polytopes and matroids, if you take a random structure, simple or simplicial polytope, certainly you won't get equational constraints. That, but maybe we'll hear more, have more discussion about this later. I don't know. So can you say a bit more about?
I just mentioned this. I don't talk about this, but actually, it was an old problem discussed at home. Geometrical one and two and three, the range of one and